गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग। माय वॉइस इज ऑडिबल टू यू?
यस सर।
यस सर। Well, friends, good morning and welcome to today's class. Previous class, we have initiated the topic GST, which is an important indirect tax. So under indirect tax, we'll be learning two kinds of taxes. One is GST, other one is the customs duty. Both the things we'll be covering. GST you had initiated, we have understood there is something called as CGST, there is something called as SGST, there is something called as IGST, there is something called as the UGST or UTGST. These are the concepts you have understood. Let me quickly recapitulate what you have learned so far. I'm going for screen sharing right now. So previous class I had shared with you what is our tentative session plan, what are the things that we are going to cover. I have told you all this thing, right? And I had also explained you what is our evaluation process. I had shown you that these are the websites which you need to visit, and you will be getting a lot of reading material, practically relevant reading material from these websites. I expect all of you to familiarize yourself with these websites. One more website is gst.gov.in. For all practical purposes, we need to visit the website for knowing, for having the practical experience of registration, filing, return, and etc. We need to visit to this website. Then I had shown you one more website from where I told you to download the study material, which will be useful for us for study purpose. I had shown you this bill in your previous class, right? Okay,
yes, sir.
Remember this bill?
And what we learned from this bill is that every bill like this contains a particular number. That number is called as, what is this number called?
GSTN.
Okay, GST registration number or GSTN. How many digits are there in this number?
15.
15 digits are there. And we also know this number is linked to PAN. Okay, you see, PAN is also included in this number, is it not? PAN contains 10 digits and GSTN contains 15 digits. So there are 5 extra digits are there. And by this time, you must have understood what is the meaning of these first two digits?
State code.
That is state code. Very good. So you have understood. So by seeing a GST invoice, trust you will be able to understand that this is from which state. Okay, then what else we have learned from this invoice? That in invoice, when supplier is supplying some goods or service, then it should clearly specify that how much he is collecting by way of GST. Okay, it should specify this much of money is collected from GST. And also it should be specified that GST is what kind of GST. Is it SGST, CGST, or IGST, or UGST? All these things should be there. Is it not? Okay. Please keep on responding.
Yes, sir.
Right. This is what we have understood in previous class. And we have also understood that when it says it is from a different state, and here the state is Karnataka, accordingly GST starts from the these two digits 29 is the state code from Karnataka. These are things we have understood. And we have understood this supplier is from Karnataka and the buyer is from, or the receiver, recipient is from which state?
Odisha.
Recipient is from Odisha. Okay, and since it is a supplier from Karnataka to Odisha, then what kind of GST is collected here?
IGST.
IGST is collected. Good. So IGST is collected because of this reasons. Okay, I think you have now clear. And this is what kind of invoice we call it? Is it B2C invoice or B2B invoice?
B2C.
B2C. Why you are calling it as a B2C invoice?
Because the supplier is having the GST registration number, whereas the receiver doesn't have
it. It is assumed the receiver is the ultimate consumer, and you know in indirect tax what happened? Ultimate consumer will bear the consequence of tax. It cannot pass it further. Here the recipient or the ultimate consumer doesn't have GST. Okay, so this is a B2C invoice. Okay, that is what we have understood so far. I showed you one more invoice also. Here I showed you, see, this is the GSTN. Here also 15 digit GSTN. This is a GSTN of the supplier. And this is the GSTN of the recipient. Right, what kind of invoice we'll call it?
B2B.
B2B. Okay, B2B invoice. Here the recipient can take credit. Whatever GST has been paid in this purchase, he can take credit. And incidentally, you see, both GSTNs are starting from the code 21. Here also 21, here also 21. What does it indicate?
It's from the same city.
It is
same
from the
state.
Meaning it is interstate supply. Very good. That means this is an interstate supply. If it is an interstate supply, then what kind of GSTs I will be charging for? Should I charge IGST? Or should the supplier charge IGST?
What are CGST and SGST?
CGST and SGST only. No IGST will be levied in this kind of invoices. Okay. And what is CGST and IGST? The same thing. That means, what is CGST and SGST? That is, you can say half of the entire GST amount will be accounted under CGST and half will be under SGST. Meaning, suppose GST rate is 18%, so 9% will be CGST and 9% will be SGST. Okay, had it been an interstate supply, the entire thing could have been 18% could have been collected under IGST and entire 5,796, that's the total of both these amounts, should have been paid in the form of IGST. Okay, right?
Yes, sir.
And okay, also, sir, you have understood if someone is collecting GST in whatever form, maybe in the form of IGST, CGST, HGST, or UGST, what you have to ensure, only one, at least one thing should be there in that invoice, what you are going to ensure, what you are going to check, whether GST collection is a valid collection or not. How can you know that? How you will be able to know that this person who is collecting CGST and SGST is authorized to make that collection? is legally authorized to make that collection. How will you be able to ensure that?
Sir, if the PAN number and the PAN number is mentioned in the GSTN, or sir, if the GSTN number of digits is...
Yeah, PAN number he may mention, may not mention, it is up to him. But if GSTN is there, that means he is a registered person. Okay, person's definition we have understood in your previous class. He's a registered person. If he's a registered person, he is bound once this GST. Only when he is registered person, he is authorized to make GST collection. And he is also supposed to deposit the GST amount with government. Okay, this is what we have understood. I had shown you one more invoice, and here I explained you. Here also you can see this is a GSTN. This is customer GSTN. That means this is it is coming. You see supply. This is customer GSTN, and this is supplier GSTN. Now tell me, is it an interstate supplier? Interstate supply.
Interstate.
Interstate supply. If you feel interstate, then whether I should levy SGST, IGST, CGST, or UTGST.
IGST.
IGST. You see, you check this invoice whether IGST is levied. Is it levied correctly?
Yes, sir.
You can see IGST is levied, not CGST. SGST is not levied. That money will be deposited under IGST account. Okay, fine. So one more invoice. You tell me what kind of supply is it? Interstate or intrastate?
Interstate, sir.
Which one? This is?
Sir, can you repeat?
This is what
sir,
kind of interested. Yeah, it is interested supply because this is UC customer's GSTN. This is your fine supplier GSTN. Both starts with the state code 21. That means both of them are from same state. And you can check their address also. Both of them are on same state. Consequently, what is to be levied? Should I levy or should the supplier levy IGST in this case?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
But they should levy?
CGST,
SGST. Levied, you see, CGST and SGST. Okay. Okay, understood up to this?
Yes, sir.
And also, I told you, levied means it is collected. CGST and SGST are collected. But after collection, if you are a registered supplier, what you are supposed to do with that collected money? What is to be done?
Can you repeat?
Yeah, I'm asking. Suppose you are a registered person, you are a registered dealer, and you are collecting CGST, SGST, IGST from customers. After collection, what you are supposed to do with that money?
Deposit with the government, sir.
You have to deposit. This is the deposit challan. And when you are depositing, again, one more thing you have to see, it has to be deposited under appropriate heads. You see, IGST money has to be deposited under IGST head. CGST money, whatever had been collected, has to be deposited under CGST head. Right? And SGST money, if it is collected, it has to be deposited under SGST. So under different heads, you have to deposit. Okay. So, in your business, when you do accounting, you have to also open various ledgers. Different ledgers should be there so that you can understand that how much money is collected under different heads and how much of this money is to be going to be deposited. Of course, before depositing, you have to see if there is some input credit that has to be adjusted. Is it done? This process of input credit, process of availing and utilization of input credit will be learning subsequently, but at this stage, you should have an idea, not that entire money which is collected is to be deposited. How much of it is going to be deposited? Who can say? Who can say how whether the entire money is going to be deposited or some adjustments are required? Shweta? No idea?
Sir, the CG, sir, the GST.
Should I repeat the question?
Sir, just a second. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Question is that suppose the supplier is collecting some money under the head IGST and some money under the head CGST and some money under the head SGST. The question is that whether the entire money is to be deposited with government or there is a possibility that supplier will make some adjustment with that money. Something is to be deducted therefrom. Whether the entire money is to be deposited or after deducting something it will be deposited. No idea,
sir. Can I ask a doubt related
to total?
Yeah, you have a doubt, please ask it first.
Sir, so suppose there is a credit transaction, right? So will the supplier noted in the books that GST is accrued?
Yeah,
sir. So if the supplier has mentioned it in the books, he does not have to technically give it to the government because he has not actually collected it.
Let me answer that question. Please repeat. Who is answering this? Who is asking this question?
Sir, Anurag.
Anurag. Okay, Anurag.
Sir, do you want me to repeat?
One second. Yeah, please repeat the question.
So, sir, suppose a supplier is selling on credit.
Supplier is selling on credit. Yeah. Then.
Right. So will he mention GST in his books? Like the tax that is to be collected,
yeah,
once he receives.
Right.
So suppose a transaction is between, so there must be a GST submission or collection day, or do we have, or is it arbitrary and we can submit it anytime, GST?
When you can from collect it, yeah.
So we can only give GST once you have collected it.
Who told you? No, don't. That is not right. Okay, let me explain you. First of all, you see, sales is a sales. There is no difference between cash sale and credit sale. Okay, yes, so you have studied accounting also. You have studied how revenue is to be recognized. The moment you are raising an invoice, on credit sale, are you not raising invoice?
Yes, sir.
When you are making credit sale, are you raising invoice or not? That means, are you giving a bill or not? You are giving a bill.
Yes, sir.
Right, the moment you are recognizing, you are let us say you are raising a bill, that means you are recognizing it as a revenue.
Yes, sir.
That is the point when you have made a supply. We'll be learning the definition of supply at that time. I'll be able to clarify it further. But right now you understand the moment you are raising a bill, then that is a supply, and you are supposed to pay GST on that. Normally, by 28th of the following month. Other due dates I will be telling you subsequently.
Okay,
but by the next month, 28th, you are supposed to pay GST. That is one thing. Second thing is also, one more thing also you should know. Let us say you have received some payment and you have not yet supplied. You have received some payment, maybe advance. Then also you are supposed
to.
Then also you have to generate invoice immediately and pay GST, even if you have not supplied.
Okay.
So point here is that if you are generating an invoice, supply has been made, and you have to pay GST on this.
Okay, sir.
Right. Is it clear, all of you? And don't keep the impression that you see money has not been collected, so GST liability doesn't arise. No. Money has been collected or not collected, that is not an issue. Under GST law, we will not consider it. We are not going to consider that thing. Whether money has been collected or not, that is a business issue. Okay. Any other query you have? Any other doubt anybody is having? Well, now my question is that, let us say, in a month you have collected under different heads, you will be collecting GST, is it done? As you have understood, something will be collected under the head IGST if I have made some interstate supply, something will be collected under the head CGST, and something will be collected under the head SGST or UTGST. Okay, now before depositing, I have to do one more thing, that is there any credit available to me how credit will be available? If I have purchased something, I have used some input goods or input services, that on those inputs I might have paid some GST. Is it not? There might be IGST payment, there might be CGST payment, there might be SGST or UPGST payment. Yes or no? On my purchases?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that amount which has been paid on inputs, that needs to be adjusted. So that money can be utilized towards payment of my output liability. Meaning, input liability can be utilized for payment of output liability. Okay. I repeat, suppose let us say there is a output liability of 50,000, but there is an input credit of 20,000. So how much I have to pay?
So can you repeat that?
Question is, there is an output liability of 50,000. 50,000 is payable. And there is an input credit of 20,000. How much money has to be paid?
30,000.
30,000 has to be paid. So this adjustment has to be paid. 30,000 has to be paid by cash or banking system. 20,000 indirectly you are paying by utilizing your credit. Are you getting?
Yes,
20,000 also you are paying. But how you are paying? By utilization of your input credit you are paying. Understood? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm going for screen sharing once again. In case you are getting doubt, feel free to ask in between. And some of you have not yet marked attendance in the chat box. Please do it. That will help us reconciling the auto attendance. Automatical attendance will be taken at any point of time. But to be doubly sure of make yourself doubly sure that your presence is marked, put your roll number in the chat box. Yeah. So what is this I am showing you? What you are seeing on the screen? Can you explain what is this? Who can say what is this?
It is payment received.
Yeah. This shows that this much of GST has been paid by a particular supplier. Okay. There are some due dates. We'll be learning subsequently what are the due dates, what kind of supplier, which supplier has to pay by which date. There's a normal due date, many times you get extension. So normally by 20th of the next month, GST payments are made, monthly GST payments are made after adjusting the input credit. Right? Hope it is clear up to this. And this is what I was showing you. What is this? Who can tell me? What is this document I'm showing you? Many shops, you can find this kind of certificates are displayed at a prominent place. It is supposed to be displayed at a prominent place. What is this certificate called?
A GST registration certificate.
GST registration certificate. If the certificate is there, you can see the registration number is displayed at the top. If the certificate is there, that shows the shop is registered under GST law. Meaning that shop is authorized to collect GST from you. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Oh, well. And also, we had seen that how GST law looks like, how GST Act looks like. I had shown you GST law, the structure of GST law. And we have understood there will be some chapters, sections, subsections, clauses, sub clauses, items, explanations, right, provisos, sub items, all these things will be there. And we have understood that this part of the law is called as the preamble. This talks about the purpose. After that, chapter starts. Okay. Hope did you download that book from the website?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So just keep it for reference purposes. I told you this book is for reference purposes because that contains the bare act. If you want to read, you may read it. But my intention was that you should have a reference book readily available with you. If you need to refer a particular section, then refer to that. Okay. Other materials, I'll be telling you which portions are relevant for you. But download all these materials, keep it with you. So we'll be discussing those relevant parts. So after preamble, we know in that law, chapter starts. So yesterday we initiated the chapter 1. We have seen the chapter 1, section 1. Section 1 containing three things. Who can tell me what are the contents of Section 1? Just make some attempt. Most of the acts, Section 1 contains three aspects. Can you make some attempts that what are these three things which are covered in Section 1 of any act? Most of the act you can find Section 1 contains three things. Who can tell me?
So preliminary and definitions.
Okay, that preliminary is the chapter name.
Okay, sir.
If definition is not there in Section 1. Definition will
be in Section 2.
Section 2, right, Section 2. So my question is that normally what are the things you find in Section 1? Okay, let me help you. First, definitely you will find one subsection which is called as short title. That we're talking about the title of the act. Okay, short title you can find. Then what else you can find in Section 1?
So when the act was introduced,
the date of the act.
Okay, let's say commencement.
Then commencement, yes.
Then what else?
So the provisions and on which they are applicable, like on which companies and on which regulations are they applicable?
That date means you are talking about commencement part again. So one thing is short time.
Okay, yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
Second thing is commencement. Then what else? I told you.
So then explanation of goods and services tax.
No. One more thing. Try to recall. I'll be telling you, but today at home you check. You are already having the reference book. You check what are the contents of Section 1. Section 1, if you are remembering, fine. Even if you don't remember, just have an idea that in any law, Section 1 contains these three things. One is short title. Second is extent. Third one is commencement. Extent means this law is applicable. You can say area-wise applicability. For example, GST law was initially applicable to the entire country except Jammu and Kashmir, and subsequently Jammu and Kashmir. It is also applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. Right? GST. Okay.
Yes, sir.
GST law was made effective from 1st July. When?
2017.
Very good.
2017.
And when it is made applicable to the state Jammu and Kashmir?
8th July 2017.
Excellent. Very good. Very good. So this is hard. You should have some idea about the structure of law. Law you can refer. Is it not? Books are with you. You can anytime you can refer. But many times you see lawyers refer the books. But you should have a clear idea about the structure. You should know where to search. Suppose you need to know whether this law is applicable in this particular year or not. How you'll know? So you can find the answer in Section 1. There is no point in reading the entire law book. Is it not? So you should have an idea that the structure of the law. Suppose you want to know what is the definition of the persons, what we are seeing in our previous class. So you should know person definition you can find only in Section 2. There is no point in searching elsewhere. Is it not? So all of us being commerce students, we should have some idea about this kind of laws. What is the structure of this kind of laws? We should have some idea. This we have understood. What is tax? We have discussed. So this is a enforcement by the government. It's not a voluntary payment. All these things have been discussed. Then we have also discussed what is direct tax, what is indirect tax, and you know the examples. What is direct tax, what is indirect tax? Technically, if you say direct tax is a kind of tax where this thing, impact and incidence are always on the same person. And indirect tax, impact and incidence are on different person. Impact refers to the initial burden. Right. Incidence refers to the ultimate burden of the tax. Examples also we are giving. Now tell me which kind of tax is regressive in nature and which kind of tax is progressive in nature. Who can answer me?
So GST is regressive and direct tax income tax is progressive.
Okay. Why we call GST is a regressive kind of tax, regressive tax system? Why you
sir, call because, it? Because everyone has to pay the same amount of GST on a certain product.
Yeah.
Sir, it is not based on income. Yeah, it's not based on income level.
irrespective of economic condition of a person, everybody has to pay same amount of tax. Right, economic conditions of the citizens are not dealt with in the tax rates. Okay, so this aspect you have understood. Some of the features of indirect tax also we have discussed. It's a very important source of revenue. It is a tax which is applicable on commodities and the services. And here, burden of the tax is shifted by the collector to the ultimate user. The person who is collecting the tax is ultimately shifts the burden to the ultimate user, to the consumer. And in this kind of tax, this kind of taxes, you don't perceive the pinch of paying tax. It is inflationary in nature because it is included in the price. So it brings a, it leads to a kind of inflation. Tax base is very wide. Almost most of the services and goods are covered under this tax name. It promotes social welfare also by providing, levying heavy taxes on unwanted goods like tobacco products, alcoholic products, all these seen goods. More taxes are levied. This is how social welfare is taken care of. And it is a regressive nature. Why it is regressive? You know that. Okay, these are the aspects you have understood. And this is the genesis of GST in India. We have discussed in our previous classes. Two dates are relevant for us. 1st July and 8th July. 1st July is more relevant. 1st July of 2017 and 8th July of 2017-16 was introduced. So, also one more thing you know, that we have got a kind of dual GST model. What does it mean when you say the dual tax regime or dual GST model? What does it mean? Who can tell me? Anybody who can explain this talk? In India, you follow a dual tax regime. So far as GST is concerned. Anyone?
Means the center and the state both can collect the tax.
Yeah, center and state both will be collecting the tax. So this has been purposefully we have adopted this dual tax design, considering the federal structure of our country. So consciously that decision has been taken. Okay, few more concepts we will be learning today. First concept is that GST is a value-added tax. Value-added tax means your tax is levied on value addition. Okay, what is the meaning of value-added tax? Let me explain you this with the help of some example. Okay, how we are saying GST is a value-added tax? Let us see. Let us think. Is it visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now tell me.
Yes, sir.
Suppose. So earlier, you know, we had a tax system which is called as the VAT. Prior to that, there's a tax which is called as the sales tax. Right? Have you heard of sales tax? Central sales tax, Odisha Sales Tax Act. Have you heard of all these things?
Yes, sir. Sales tax.
Okay, this kind of tax system was there in some part of some time back. When I say it is a sales tax, that means whenever you are making a sales, you have to pay tax. It is a tax on sales. Right? Sales are made and taxes has to be paid. Okay. In that system, let us say sales tax system, earlier system, what was happening? Let us say you are manufacturing something. Let us take an example. You are manufacturing a table. Okay. Wooden table you are manufacturing. So you will be purchasing wood. Right, wood you will be purchasing, is it not? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You might purchase paint. You may purchase laminate. All these things you will be purchasing, and you will be paying some amount. let us say in all these things you are paying 1000 rupees. Not only 1000 rupees, you will be paying sales tax. When you are purchasing, somebody must have sold to you. He must have collected sales tax. Let us say sales tax is 10%. That means he is collected 1100 from you. 1000 for material and 1100 for and 100 for what? Sales tax.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? This is what collected. Now what?
Can you repeat, sir?
Exactly.
Can you repeat?
Yeah. Let me repeat this example. Let us say you are manufacturing a wooden table. For wooden table, you will be needing wood. You will be needing paint. You will be needing laminate. All these things you are going to purchase.
Okay, sir.
Okay. And let us say you are paying 1000 rupees for this. For this material and 100 rupees as sales tax. Total how much you are paying?
1100.
1100 rupees you are paying. Okay. 1100 rupees you are paying. 1100 rupees is your cost which includes tax. Now assume you will be converting all these materials into a finished goods called table. Is it done?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
When you convert it into a table, let us say you are selling the table at 2000 rupees. How much? At 2000 rupees you are selling the table. Okay. Now when you will be selling the table, you are incurring a sales transaction. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And
yes,
sir. Here again you have to pay sales tax. Let us say sales tax is also 10%. So another 200. At what price you will be able to sell? Finally at what is the total price in which you are selling it?
2200.
Okay. Now when you are selling, you tell me how much money you will be depositing with government.
100 rupees.
We are talking about the sales tax system. Sales tax system, how much money you have collected?
200
rupees.
200 collected. So how much money you will be depositing with government?
200
rupees is deducted because it is tax on sale. It is not a tax on value addition. Okay, sales is 2000, therefore you are paying 10% of this. But GST is not a tax on sales.
Tax,
yeah.
That 2000 we will take from customers.
Yes, you will be collecting from the customer 2200.
Okay.
Okay, it is different story that you might have when purchased, you have paid 100 rupees. That doesn't matter. Because this is, we are talking about sales tax system. Here tax is to be levied on sales.
Okay, sir.
Okay, here charging event is sales. When sales is made, you have to pay this much of tax. Sales tax system is not a bad system, but GST is a bad system. But let us say same thing is happening under GST. Okay, let us say it is not sales tax, it is GST. If it is GST, you know how much you have to pay. You are supposed to pay 200, is it not? You are supposed to pay 200, but you are already having an input credit of how much?
100, sir.
100. So you will be paying 200 by way of gas 100. Gas 100. And input credit another 100. Your liability will be reduced by 100. Your definitely your liability is 200, but you will be paying 100 rupees. Okay, you are paying 100 rupees only because input credits are adjusted here. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Sir.
Now you try to understand. Finally, how much government is collecting from you? 100 rupees under GST regime. Okay. Okay. Now that is point number one, that your government is collecting 100 rupees. Now let us talk about one more thing. Now please tell me, you have purchased material for how much, excluding taxes, for how much amount you have purchased material? What is the value of your raw material?
1,000 rupees.
And when you convert it, if raw materials are converted into table, what is its value now?
2,000 rupees.
That means 1,000 has been converted to 2,000. My question is now, how much value addition you have made? You have made some value addition?
1,000.
Okay. You have made value addition 1,000. So since GST is a tax on value addition, you are supposed to pay tax on value addition. And you have made value addition of 1,000. So you have to pay 10% of that. That is 100 rupees you are supposed to pay, which you are paying. That is why effectively it is called GST is a value addition. But how effectively you are not paying on sales. You are not paying on your value of your supply. You are paying on the value addition effectively. How effectively you are paying on the value addition? The government is allowing you to utilize the input credit. You are paying on your output liability after adjusting the input credit. So effectively, you are paying tax on what? On the value addition. Is it clear to you? That is why it is called as GST is a value added tax. It is not a tax on the transaction. It's a tax on value, not on the transaction. Is it clear to you why GST is called as a value added tax? So, otherwise what will happen? Every stage one have to pay tax in the earlier system or the sales tax was there. Okay, let us say somebody will take your table and combine it with some other furniture, make a sofa set and sell it. Then again, he has to pay sales tax on that. In that system, what will happen? There will be tax on tax. You will be purchasing raw material which contains tax. And again, on that tax also, you will be paying tax. That is what we call it as cascading effect. Under GST, cascading effect is not there. You will not be paying tax on tax. You will be paying tax on value addition. Right? Otherwise, when the raw material itself includes tax and when we are selling a product, that sale price also includes price of the raw material including tax. So, you are paying tax on tax. So, under GST regime, cascading effect of tax is not there. Tax will be levied only on value addition. Is it clear? Is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Going for screen sharing once again. Just give me a minute. So, now, definitely you will agree now, GST is a value-added tax. Is it not? And GST offers continuous and comprehensive chain of tax credit. Continuous chain of credit, tax credit means if you are a registered supplier, you are having a GSTN, then whenever you are purchasing something, automatically you can avail a credit. Is it not? And that can be set up against your output tax liability. And let us say someone is purchasing from you, he can also avail credit. Let us say A is purchasing from B. B can take credit and C is purchasing from B. C can take credit. D is purchasing from C. D can also take credit. So continuously, the credit chain will continue till it reaches the ultimate consumer. Ultimate consumer cannot pass on the credit. Okay, suppose you are purchasing something. Let us say you are ordering something from Amazon. You are ordering a book. You are paying GST, but you have to bear that GST. Can you transfer it to some other person? Can you transfer? Yes or no? Are you getting my question?
No, sir. Can you repeat?
question is that suppose you are ordering a book from Amazon, you are paying GST on it. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Can you transport this GST to somebody else?
So the tax board also, no, sir.
No, because you are the ultimate consumer, you have to bear the consequence of that. But suppose you are a bookseller and you are ordering some books, then you can transfer the credit.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? So, under GST, this continuous chain of tax credit operates till the product or till the services reaches the ultimate consumer. Ultimate consumer cannot transfer it. He has to bear it. Okay. So, one thing we discussed, it's a value-added tax. Secondly, there is a continuous chain of tax credit under the GST system. And this burden is transferred from person to person till it reaches the final consumer. The final consumer bears the tax credit. Okay. And as you have discussed a little earlier, that it's a kind of value-added tax. Since it's a value-added tax, there is no tax on tax. Or there is no cascading of tax. Cascading effect is not there under GST system. Are you agreeing with all these features of GST or all these concepts of GST? Or you have any query, feel free to ask. Any query you have up to this?
No, sir.
Okay, good. Well, having understood this, I'll just give you some idea. You need not remember all this. These are, in fact, history. So these are, you see, several taxes, almost 22 kind of taxes, which are merged with CGST. So you may tell somebody that, you see, there was a time so in our country, so many kind of taxes are there. Now, everything is merged with CGST. With CGST, there will be no Central Sales Tax Act, there is no VAT, there is no education sales, etc. No, all these things, which were sales, physical and sales, purchase tax. All these things are merged with CGST. Okay. These are merged with around 22 kind of tax. And you see, there are again almost around 7 kind of tax which are subsumed with SGST. Okay, all this tax, VAT, entertainment tax, luxury tax, taxes on lottery, etc. All these things are merged with SGST. Okay, so it is a simpler system. So therefore, it is talked about one tax. So not so many taxes in our one tax, one measure. Okay, and there are some taxes which are still not included in GST. Maybe it is gradually in a phased manner. It may be included, but right now, these are some taxes which are not included in GST. Okay. Now here we are going to learn one more concept, that GST is a destination-based tax. When you talk about indirect tax, there are two options, or you can say there are two possibilities. It can be an origin-based tax or it can be a destination-based tax. In India, the kind of system we have adopted is called as destination-based tax, or it is a consumption tax. Okay. Right. Under consumption tax, what happens? The place of consumption will decide the state which will collect the tax. Let us say in our country, you know, there are some states which are producing states. They produce a lot of goods and services. Okay. Let us say Gujarat, Maharashtra, etc. They produce. They are producing. And some states are consuming states. Their production is less, but consumption is little more, like Odisha, Bihar, etc. They are consuming states. And GST is a consumption-based tax in the sense, suppose a particular product is consumed in Odisha. Okay. So the place of consumption is state of Odisha. So the GST collection, the money collected from that supply, should go to the state of Odisha, not to the producing state. That is why it is called as consumption-based tax. Here, the place of consumption will decide the state that will collect tax. Ultimate collection will be made by Odisha state and it will be kept by Odisha state. Understood? What is the meaning of consumption-based tax?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, we will be learning it further also. Subsequently, again, we will be explaining. At this case, preliminary classes, we are learning at very basic level. We'll see it with the help of some examples. How? What is the meaning of consumption-based tax? Yeah, this thing I was talking to you that various possibilities are there. GST structure in our country is that we follow a dual GST structure, as you can see here. There may be possibility of central GST, means only central government can levy tax. State GST, only state government can levy tax, but we are not adopting any of this. We are adopting a dual GST regime, that means center as well as state, both of them can levy GST, can collect GST. That is the meaning of dual GST structure. Okay, and further we will be discussing about dual GST structure in our subsequent class. We'll stop here right now. We'll catch up at the next class. We'll start our discussion on dual GST structure and some other issues we'll be discussing. Okay, thank you very much. Let's catch up at our next class. Thanks a lot.